欢迎收看今天文倩的世界周报亚洲版。前面我们先祝大家耶诞节快乐，不过也在这个时刻我们来做一下年度的回顾。这一整下来，国际政治的局势有非常大的改变。这个改变呢，最大的主轴就是美中的对峙从川普的时代延续到了拜登，而且他的整个对峙从经贸的对峙、关税的对峙、科技的对峙变成军事全面性的对峙，更符合原来人们所说的冷战时期的情况。而和冷战时期不同的是，它不只是和冷战相同非常危险的军事对峙，还包括了经贸的、科技的各方面的国力的竞争，所以是全方位的对峙，是人类从来没有过的经验。在这样的情况里头，很多国家都选择了在美中对峙中，有的是选择站边，例如五眼联盟、英国、加拿大、澳洲等，包括日本，包括台湾，也有很多国家选择不结盟，这里头包括了欧盟，这里头也包括了阿拉伯联合大公国，这里头也甚至包括了美国认为他在印太战略里头最重要的印度，他回过头去跟俄罗斯合作，因为他认为他最大的敌人是中国。所以世界的局势在过去这一年里头，它可以说是一个划时代的历史性的一年。2021年划时代的可能不是疫情，最严重的就是这个局势呢可能会持续相当的久，而这个持续的过程当中，很多人忽略了它可能带给一个世代、两个世代长期的影响。请看我们以下的整理和分析。
如果终须一战，会是何种光景？
拿起钢枪，就要放下儿女情长，穿上军装，就要舍弃舒适安逸，征战疆场，男儿本色，从军报国，死生无悔。
China is flexing its military muscle, trialing its new aircraft carrier at sea a few weeks ago, and last year parading some of its latest missile technology through Beijing. President Xi Jinping addressed China's National People's Congress last month, saying China should comprehensively strengthen the training of troops and combat preparedness.
Washington is alarmed. The first national defense strategy in 10 years.Spells out the number one threat to American vital interests.
Great power competition, not terrorism, is now the primary focus of U.S. national security.
从2018年川普政府发布的国防战略报告点名中国威胁，到2021年拜登阁员首次外交出访就选定东亚，这两年多的物换星移，尽管华府人事全非，尽管异常疫情翻天覆地，但不变的甚至持续升高的却是美中由和转进的大国对抗态势。
For the last 2 decades, we've been necessarily focused on issues in the Middle East. And while we were focused on issues in the Middle East, China has modernized its military. In addition to that, it has engaged in aggressive and in some cases coercive behavior. And some of that behavior has been directed against our allies in the region. And so our goal is to...make sure that we maintain a competitive edge over China or anyone else.
Welcome to the new age of bloated Pentagon budgets, all to be justified by the great Chinese threat.
当中美关系论述的调性从软实力的竞争转向硬实力的对抗，大 大众舆论与国际社会的吸收反应，往往是比拳头盘点谁的军事力量能压制对方，谁的武器较先进，谁的装备更领先。从战机导弹到航母坦克，计算数量更计较质量，落后的一方固然加以追赶，领先的一方也唯恐目前的优势被超越，在生存本能的驱使下一头栽入军备竞赛的逻辑陷阱里。
The United States has nearly 20 times the number of nuclear warheads as China. It has twice the tonnage of warships at sea, including 11 nuclear-powered aircraft carriers, compared with China's two carriers, which are much less advanced. Washington has over 2,000 modern fighter jets, compared to Beijing's roughly 600. China spends about $250 billion on its military, which is a third as much as the United States.Michael O'Hanlon of the Brookings Institution notes that if China were in NATO, we would berate it for inadequate burden sharing since its military outlays fall well below NATO's 2% minimum. In requesting even more money for his region, the head of the Indo-Pacific Command, Admiral Davidson, remarked on China's increases in defense spending.
I cannot for the life of me understand some of the capabilities that they're putting in the field unless it is an aggressiveposture.
But the fact that Washington is spending more on the military than it did at the height of the Vietnam War, even accounting for inflation, should threaten no one.
哈佛学者出身的 CNN 政治评论家扎卡利亚对于华府部分明代与军方人士把美中两大阵营的矛盾窄化为军事武力上的较劲极不赞同。他认为一昧追求军火技术的先进和武器数量的压制，不但舍本逐末，而且方向错误，因为中国的军事花费从比例上来看与美国的国防预算仍有极大的差距，而北京在当今全球的影响力之所以得以迅速扩张，靠的并非船坚炮利，而是巧妙渗透的经济力。这一点美国学界其实早有共识，且屡屡向华府提出反制的对策与谏言，却没有获得急于塑造外在敌人谋取政治利益的川普政府正视与采纳。
Consider two contrasting exercises of power.America's F-35 fighter jet program, bedeviled by cost overruns and technical problems, will ultimately cost taxpayers $1.7 trillion, according to a document obtained by Bloomberg. China will likely spend a comparable amount of money on its Belt and Road Initiative, an ambitious set of loans, aid, and financing for infrastructure projects across the world.Aimed at creating greater interdependence with dozens of countries that are important to Beijing. Which do you think is money better spent?
To remind myself how astonished I should be, I occasionally look out the window in my office in Cambridge at this bridge, which goes across the Charles River between the Kennedy School and Harvard Business School. In 2012, the state of Massachusetts said they were going to renovate this bridge. It would take 2 years.In 2014, they said it wasn't finished. In 2015, they said it would take one more year. In 2015, they said it's not finished. We're not going to tell you when it's going to be finished. Finally, last year, it was finished 3 times over budget. Now, compare this to a similar bridge that I drove across last month in Beijing. It's called the Shenyang Bridge. In 2015, the Chinese decided they wanted to renovate that bridge. It actually has twice as many lanes of traffic.How long did it take for them to complete the project? Take a look. The answer is 43 hours.
We all know China does bad stuff. They break promises about Hong Kong autonomy. They put Uyghurs in camps and punish dissent. And we don't want to be that. ButIt's got to be something between authoritarian government that tells everyone what to do and a representative government that can't do anything at all. Their new Silk Road Initiative is the biggest infrastructure project in history, indebting not just that continent, but large parts of Asia, Europe, and the Middle East to the people who built their roads, bridges, and ports. In China alone, they have 40,000 kilometers of high-speed rail. America has none. Our fastest train is the train that goes around the zoo.
Let's build wireless networks into rural communities so everybody can tap into world markets. Let's put construction workers back to work.
A $1 trillion infrastructure plan to build new roads and bridges and airports and tunnels and highways and railways all across our great nation.
On a national level, we've been having Infrastructure Week every week since 2009, but we never do anything.
或许是为了摆脱过去10年美国基础建设倾颓失修、对比中国突飞猛进、更显捉襟见肘的难堪形象，拜登总统在解决疫情纾困的燃眉之急后，已经把目光转移到下一个施政重点，投入桥梁、道路、轨道建设、通讯网络、电动车技术以及半导体制程与人工智慧等先进技术研发，以此解决美国现所面临基建缺乏。 气候变迁和劳工就业等诸多问题，并且在5G标准和制造业等领域急起直追，一方面逐步切断对中国供应链的依赖，一方面更要拉大与中国的技术水平差距，确保美国在涉及国安各领域都能不受中国的挑战。 威胁，但值得万味的是，当霸权角力的擂台已经摆下，目标锁定，对抗成模式，美国的壮大是否就意味着中国的退让，还是引发更多的碰撞？科技力、经济力、文化力的竞争是否终将导向军事力的冲突？历史上人类征战的英剑，值得我们此刻再一次省思。